Hey there, this is Andrew. Thank you for joining me. Today, we're going to be continuing our work on our chess pieces, where we're going to be expanding our functionality to more fit each role of the pieces. We'll be briefly going over all of the pieces, but this video is going to be focusing on the functionality for both the pawn as well as the king. And then we'll be finishing up the functionality for the knight in the next video. So let's go ahead and switch over to Unity so I can show you a few of the assets that we're going to be needing. And the main thing that we're going to be needing are all of these icons that we're going to be using for all of our pieces. So we're going to be using icons for the bishop, the king, the rook, and all that good stuff. And I've taken all of these and I've cropped them to be a size of 60 by 60. And these are just some I got off of a Google search. You can go and get your own. They're not particularly unique in any way. But one thing you do have to note is once you have all of your images ready, you want to put them in a folder called resources. Because when we initiate each of our new game pieces, we're going to be making a call to the resources folder to set the sprite. And we do this because when you use the command add component, it doesn't keep the defaults for references to assets. So if we added the component and tried to use one of the default references, it would just come up null. So that's why we have to put it in resources. It's also just kind of a clean way of just getting assets into your scene without having to have any public fields or anything like that. So that's all we need in terms of assets. So let's go ahead and hop into Visual Studio so we can start to look at some of the pieces. And this is the rook, where all of the pieces similar to the rook are going to look the same. And what we have here is another version of our setup that we have in our base piece. What we're overriding it, seeing is that we made our original setup in our base piece class virtual. But on this first line within the function, we're still going to be calling that base setup function, which again, if you forgot, our setup is basically our constructor for this game piece. And when we call that setup, we're going to be passing in the new team color, the sprite color, and a reference to the piece manager. But after we call that, we want to set the movement as well as the sprite for this piece. And the movement does dictate what direction that the piece can move in. And a few videos ago, I talked about how that movement value worked. Like for the x value of the vector 3, it's going to be the horizontal, and for the Y, it's going to be just the vertical direction, and then the Z is going to be diagonal. And since we're in the rook piece, it can move both horizontal and vertical, so therefore we have 7 and 7, because it can move pretty much across the entire board. But it can't move diagonally, so for the Z value, we put 0. So once we've set the movement, we want to get the component for our image and access the sprite. And then this is where we're going to be calling to that resources folder. And we're going to be using the function called resources.load. And we're going to be passing in the name, which is going to be t_rook. And it has to match the name of the asset exactly, or it's not going to work. And generally, when you do this, when you load an asset, you'll have to cast it in some way. So as you can see here, we've added the keyword sprite in these angle braces, or brackets, I think they are. And that's all we need for the rook. I'm quickly going to go through all of the other pieces and just quickly explain if there are any differences, but other than that, I'm sure you get the idea. So moving on to the knight, unfortunately we're not going to be going over the movement because the knight's movement is very unique to that piece, so we're going to be covering it in the next video. But we are still making a call to that base setup function as well as loading the sprite. Then moving on to the bishop, it's very similar to the rook, except for our movement, we have a x and a y of 0 for our movement, and the z value is going to be 7. And then we're just setting the sprite. And then taking a quick look at the queen, as you can tell, she can move in all directions. So for her x, y, and z movement, they're all going to be 7. And then we're just going to be loading her sprite. Now let's take a look at the king. Where, again, very similar, but for the movement, we have values as 1 all across, because it can move both horizontally, vertically, and diagonally, but it can only move at one piece or one space per movement. And then specifically for the king, we are going to be adding a new function that's going to be overriding the kill that's within the base class. So when we kill this piece, we also want to go to the piece manager and check that boolean that we wrote that tests for is king alive. So we set that boolean to false, and then once the turn has ended, we know that the game has ended and we need to reset the board. Now let's move on to the pawn. And as you can imagine, or actually maybe not believe, that the pawn is pretty much the complex piece that we're going to have to deal with because it has a lot of conditional movement where it can only move diagonally if an enemy piece is present, and can also move two spaces if it's its first move. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to have a boolean that we're naming is first move, and we're going to be setting it to true. Then moving into our setup function, we're also going to be setting that boolean to true again, and that's to account for when the game is reset. And then moving on down to the movement, where it's a little bit different, where we're doing a ternary operator to check to see if the color is either black or white. And this is because the pawn can only move forward, but if we don't change this value, the black pieces that are on the top of the board, or the top of the screen, need to be able to move towards the white pieces. So they basically have to move down the board. So what we're doing here is if it's white, it'll move up, and if it's black, it'll move down. And this is denoted by the vector 3 int that's 0, 1, 1, or the vector 3 that's 0, negative 1, negative 1. And then like before, we're just setting the sprite. And then moving on down below, we're going to be overriding our move that's in our base class. And on the first line within this function, we're going to be making a call to that base move, and then we're going to be setting our first move to false. So that means once the piece is moved, we're going to be checking that boolean to false. So it can only move twice its first move, and then can't move twice after that. And like I mentioned before, the pawn has a few sort of conditional movements that it can make. So when it can move diagonally, it's only when an enemy piece is present. So we have this function that's called matchesState, where we're going to be passing in a x and a y value for a cell on the board, as well as a target state that we want to be testing for. And on the first line, we're just going to be holding a cell state, and we're going to be initializing it to none. And then we're going to be setting that cell state by making a call to the validateCell function within our board, and we're going to be passing in the target y, the target x, and a reference to this piece. And then in this if statement, we're going to be testing our cell state that we just got from that validateCell function, and we're going to be checking against our target state. And then in this case, we may be checking to see if the target state is empty or if the target state contains an enemy, seeing as that the pawn cannot take enemies when it's moving forward, but it can diagonally. And then once we've added that cell to our highlighted cells list, we're going to be returning true or we're going to be returning false. And then in the function below that we're calling checkPathing, that we're overriding the checkPathing function within our base class, we're going to have something very similar where we have an integer for our current x and our current y that's getting our board position. And then we're making a call to that matchesState function that we just created, where we are passing in the current x minus the current movement.z and the current y adding to the movement.z. And this is to check for those diagonal directions that the pawn can attack at, because we're also passing in the cell state of enemy, because that's the cell state that we need for to pass the check for our pawn to be able to move. And then we need to check to see if it can move forward on the line here, where we're making another call to matchesState, where we are getting the current x and we're using the current y and we're adding the current movement.y. And we're also checking to see if the cell state is free. And then within this if statement, we're also checking to see if it's the first move. So we're going to be needing to see if we need to multiply our y movement by 2. So we can move 2 extra spaces, or 1 extra space, and also passing in the cell state of free. And then much like before, we're doing another matchesState for the top right. And that's all the programming that we're going to be doing for this video. So we go ahead and hop back into Unity and we hit the play button. You should be able to move all of your pieces with the exception of the knight around the board, and they should move and behave accurately to how they should. So the pawn can move 2 spaces when it starts, 1 space after that. The rook can only move horizontally and vertically, and the bishop can move only diagonally, and the queen can pretty much do whatever she likes. And that about does it for this video. In the next one, we're going to be finishing up the knight as well as putting some finishing touches on our project. So thank you for joining me today. If you liked the video, please feel free to leave a like, and if you would like to see our last video next week, feel free to subscribe, and I'll see you next time.